Hey friends, I'm so glad you're joining us today. We are in a series titled Stuck in My Head. Have you ever been stuck mentally? Obviously, this pandemic has a lot of us locked down physically, but the bigger challenge is where we are mentally. We can't quite get out of our own heads. We're stuck with our own thoughts, and our thoughts are not helping us. We're wrestling with fear and anxiety and depression. Sometimes we just want to give up on life. You know what? We need a new soundtrack. I don't want that soundtrack in my head any longer. It's not helping me or anybody else. If you're with me, just say, I am with you. Well, the good news is that God has given us some new songs. In fact, He's given us songs for every season of life. And today we're going to jump into Psalm 3, which is a song of deliverance. Let's read together. Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Many are saying of me, God will not deliver him. But you, O Lord, are a shield around me, my glory, the one who lifts my head high. I call out to the Lord, and he answers me from his holy mountain. I lie down and sleep. I wake again because the Lord sustains me. I will not fear, though tens of thousands assail me on every side. Arise, O Lord, deliver me, my God. Strike all my enemies on the jaw. Break the teeth of the wicked. From the Lord comes deliverance. May your blessing be on your people. Let's pause a moment and pray. Lord, we love you. And God, we give you thanks today that you are with us. And Lord, we thank you that your word says, if God is for us, who can be against us? Right now, Father, I'm asking that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit wherever we are today. Lord God, by your Spirit, give us eyes to see and ears to hear and hearts to believe all that you want to speak to us. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, the Bible meets the subject of evil head on, and not just in some abstract philosophical way, although that is there, but in the lived experiences of generations of human beings. Evil was not a theoretical concept for the psalmists. It was the reality that they were living. And if you're somewhat new to the scriptures, you may find some of their responses to evil a bit jarring. Let me give you a few examples. Appoint someone evil to oppose my enemy. Let an accuser stand at his right hand. When he is tried, let him be found guilty, and may his prayers condemn him. May his children be fatherless and his wife a widow. May his children be wandering beggars. May they be driven from their ruined homes. May a creditor seize all he has. May strangers plunder the fruits of his labor. May no one extend kindness to him or take pity on his fatherless children. May his descendants be cut off, their names blotted out from the next generation. May the iniquity of his fathers be remembered before the Lord. May the sin of his mother never be blotted out. May their sins always remain before the Lord, that he may blot out their name from the earth. One more example. Remember, Lord, what the Edomites did on the day Jerusalem fell. Tear it down, they cried. Tear it down to its foundations. Daughter Babylon, doomed to destruction, happy is the one who repays you according to what you have done to us. Happy is the one who seizes your infants and dashes them against the rocks. Wow, what do we do with this? I mean, should we be praying like that? Let me make a few observations. Firstly, we need to remember that the psalmists are not passive observers here. They are writing from the inside of terrible wickedness. I mean, they are in the middle of it. These are not some detached philosophical analyses. One theologian writes this: it would be impossible for a moral being to stand in the presence of perceived wrong, indifferent, and unmoved. Jesus burned with anger against the wrongs he met with in his journey through human life as truly as he melted with pity at the sight of the world's misery. And it was out of these two emotions that his actual mercy proceeded. Look, the adversaries in these psalms were wicked people, and the psalmists were basically imploring God to destroy evil. Wipe it out, O God. Deal with evil once and for all. Now, secondly, it was common for ancient Near Eastern authors to use what to us might sound like extravagant language to try to capture their deep emotional and psychological turmoil. I mean, the prophet Jeremiah is a great example here. Jeremiah lived through a very dark period in Israel's history, and it clearly affected him. Listen to what he says. "Cursed be the day I was born. May the day my mother bore me not be blessed. Cursed be the man who brought my father the news, who made him very glad, saying, 'A child is born to you, a son.' May that man be like the towns the Lord overthrew without pity. May he hear wailing in the morning, a battle cry at noon. For he did not kill me in the womb, with my mother as my grave, her womb enlarged forever. Why did I ever come out of the womb to see trouble and sorrow and to end my days in shame?" You know, statements like, "Yeah, today was a rough day," or "I'm feeling a little low today," just don't have the same effect. Jeremiah wanted his words to actually match the emotions and feelings he was wrestling with. Now, the psalmists are no different. They pour out their souls to God, and they don't hold back. I mean, they're not interested in sanitizing their language before they cry out to God. And we should make an interesting observation here. David is the one with whom many of these imprecatory psalms are associated, and yet, in his actual practice with other human beings, he showed surprising restraint. Let me give you a couple examples. Consider King Saul. For years, Saul made David's life a living hell. And David had multiple opportunities to kill Saul, but he wouldn't do it. Even when the people around him urged him to kill Saul, he wouldn't do it. He showed restraint. Another example, a man named Shimei pelted David with stones and cursed him as David was fleeing from Absalom, who was trying to steal the throne. And David could have wiped out this dude in a moment, and yet he commanded his men not to touch him. Now, this, I think, is an extremely important lesson for us. When we are in prayer, we need to cry out to God. Don't hold back. I mean, give your emotions full expression. But when we interact with our fellow human beings, we need to show restraint. This can save your marriage. This can save your children. This can save your work relationships. I mean, before you go tear into that person, take some time and cry out to God. I want to take a closer look at Psalm 3. So Psalm 3 is presented to us in the context of David's son Absalom trying to steal the throne from his father. Here's how the psalm is introduced. A psalm of David when he fled from his son Absalom. I mean, what a painful statement for any father. A psalm of David when he fled from his son. Now here's the backstory. Through a truly terrible series of events, Absalom had become estranged from his father David. In his anger, eventually, Absalom decided to go after the throne. Now, it turns out that Absalom was a very clever leader, and he managed to turn a great number of people against David by stirring up discontent with David's kingship. After creating a base of support in the city of Hebron, he marched up to Jerusalem. And then in very rapid succession, he takes over David's palace, he rapes the women of David's household publicly, and then he launches an operation to have David assassinated. I mean, evil was closing in on every part of David's world. And Psalm 3 is David's response. Now, none of us make it through this life without being victimized by evil. For some of us, it's relentless. Maybe it's the cumulative effects of generations of racism. Maybe it's constant verbal abuse from someone who's close to you. Maybe you were abused sexually. Maybe one of your parents was an alcoholic. Maybe you've been ostracized by your peers. Maybe you were lured into some addiction and now you can't figure out how to escape from it. What do we do? What do we do when evil threatens to destroy us? Well, number one, we need to cling to the goodness of God. We need to cling to the goodness of God. See, when we're victims of evil, it is easy to lose confidence in God's goodness. I mean, in David's case, the voices were not just in his head. He writes, "Many are saying of me, God will not deliver him." See, when we suffer evil, the natural response to think is to think either God is not there or he just doesn't care. This is why the birth of the black church in the United States is such a miracle. I mean, after generations of oppression and abuse and injustice, black men and women refuse to let go of the goodness of God. I mean, men like Frederick Douglass stared evil in the face. More than that, they bore it on their bodies and yet resolutely held fast to the goodness of God. Listen to what he writes. "I love the pure, peaceable, and impartial Christianity of Christ. I therefore hate the corrupt, slaveholding, women-whipping, cradle-plundering, partial, and hypocritical Christianity of this land. Indeed, I can see no reason but the most deceitful one for calling the religion of this land Christianity. I look upon it as the climax of all misnomers, the boldest of all frauds, and the grossest of all libels." I mean, this is astonishing. Frederick Douglass called out evil for what it was, even when it was being done in the name of Christ, and yet refused to lose sight of the goodness of God. Do you know what so many of these great men and women realized? They understood that the most heinous evils are only fatal if they separate us from God. The most heinous evils are only fatal if they separate us from God. The Apostle Paul recognized that behind the persecution that the people in his churches were experiencing was a spiritual enemy who was coming to kill their faith. I mean, listen to what he writes. "So when we could stand it no longer, we thought it best to be left by ourselves in Athens. We sent Timothy, who is our brother and co-worker in God's service and spreading the gospel of Christ, to strengthen and encourage you in your faith, so that no one would be unsettled by these trials. For you know quite well that we are destined for them. In fact, when we were with you, we kept telling you that we would be persecuted. And it turned out that way, as you well know. For this reason, when I could stand it no longer, I sent to find out about your faith. I was afraid that in some way the tempter had tempted you and that our labors might have been in vain." In the middle of every evil is a dark spiritual force whispering in our ears, "God will not deliver you. God will not deliver you." But you know what? David refused to listen to that voice. Instead, he leaned into God's goodness all the more. He wrote, "You, O Lord, are a shield around me, my glory, the one who lifts my head high. I call out to the Lord, and he answers me from his holy mountain." When evil closes in all around you, confess the goodness of God. Over and over, all throughout the Psalms, we see David remembering the goodness of God. Even in his darkest moments, he still remembered the goodness of God. I mean, consider, for example, Psalm 13. It begins with this cry, "How long, Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me?" But even in the middle of this pain, David did not lose sight of the goodness of God. And he ends the Psalm this way, "I will sing the Lord's praise, for he has been good to me." Cling to the goodness of God. Cling to the goodness of God. Number two, remember your identity. Remember your identity. One of the most damaging consequences of the evil we suffer is the effect that it can have on our own identity. See, evil does not play fair. When we are traumatized by evil, we have this tendency to personalize it in an extremely unhealthy way. I mean, we start thinking to ourselves, if this happened to me, there must be something wrong with me. I mean, there must be a reason that I'm not worth saving. Sometimes the assault on our identity is far more overt. This is obviously the case with racism. I mean, historically, racism was basically a social construct created to dehumanize and therefore to justify enslaving an entire people group. If I can strip you of your humanity, then I don't have to treat you as my brother. Many prisoners of war know this experience. Author Laura Hillenbrand, in her book Unbroken, writes about this. The prison camp guards sought to deprive them of something that had sustained them, even as all else had been lost: dignity. This self-respect and sense of self-worth, the innermost armament of the soul, lies at the heart of humanness. To be deprived of it is to be dehumanized, to be cleaved from and cast below mankind. Men subjected to dehumanizing treatment experience profound wretchedness and loneliness and find that hope is almost impossible to retain. Without dignity, identity is erased. In its absence, men are defined not by themselves, but by their captors and the circumstances in which they are forced to live. One American airman, shot down and relentlessly debased by his Japanese captors, described the state of mind that his captivity created. I was literally becoming a lesser human being. Victims of abuse know all about this. In fact, David himself knew about this reality. Now, here's why this painful lie can be so difficult to overcome. Most of us are so aware of some major faults in our own lives. And so this voice that says, you're worthless, God will never do anything through you, you are irredeemable, that's why all this is happening to you, feels to us like it's got an element of truth in it. In fact, David had some pretty major blunders in his own life. Even so, he would not allow this evil act to cause him to live in shame and humiliation. Instead, he declares, you, O Lord, are a shield around me, my glory, the one who lifts my head high. Did you catch that? I love that picture. The one who lifts my head high. Oh, David refused to let go of his identity. Centuries later, the Apostle Paul had his world revolutionized when he rebuilt his identity around the love of God. Listen to what he writes to the believers in Rome. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. No one. Friends, don't lose sight of your identity. Don't lose sight of your identity. You are loved by God. You are a son. You are a daughter. You are holy. You are blameless. You are chosen. You are blessed. You are more than a conqueror, and you will have the victory. Don't let go of your identity. Number three, don't stop feeling. Don't stop feeling. When we're victimized by evil, there is such a tendency to just slide into a blank, unfeeling world devoid of emotion and any real connection in life. Many times, we don't even realize that this is happening. We're just trying to survive. But here's the problem. When we slip into this unfeeling world, we have a tendency to cause the same pain to other people that we ourselves have experienced. Sometimes this goes right down the generational line, right? My father is distant from me. Why? Because his father was distant with him. And right on up the line, the cycle just keeps repeating itself. And if we want to see this cycle be broken, then we've got to deal with the pain in our souls that we're hiding from. And this is where the unfiltered language of the Psalms becomes so important to us. I mean, there is nothing pretty about pain. And the Psalms give us some words to express what we're feeling. Why have you forgotten me? Why must I go about mourning, oppressed by the enemy? My bones suffer mortal agony as my foes taunt me, saying to me all day long, where is your God? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and day after day of sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? Look on me and answer, Lord my God. Arise, Lord, deliver me, my God. Strike all my enemies on the jaw. Break the teeth of the wicked. May their eyes be darkened so they cannot see, and their backs be bent forever. Pour out your wrath on them. Let your fierce anger overtake them. Charge them with crime upon crime. Do not let them share in your salvation. May they be blotted out of the book of life. Look, don't stop feeling. Don't stop feeling. Express your pain to God. If you've buried it for a long time, you may need somebody to come alongside you and help you dig it up. But don't stop feeling. Express your pain to God. Look, God can deal with it. More than that, God can heal it. God can heal our pain. David says, "You, O Lord, are a shield around me, my glory, the one who lifts my head high." Don't stop feeling. Number four, reject fear. Reject fear. You know, when an athlete has a serious injury, he doesn't just need physical rehab, he needs mental rehab. I mean, many times the muscle or the bone or the ligament or the joint is actually really strong again. But even still, the athlete has trouble going 100%. How come? He's afraid of re-injuring himself. Well, this same thing happens when we experience evil in our lives. It paralyzes us. We can't sleep. We can't work. We just use all of our mental energy trying to hold the world together. I mean, we deceive ourselves into thinking that maybe by worrying or being afraid or thinking about our fear that we can control our universe. Now, this is obviously an illusion, but it's a powerful illusion. But David saw a bigger reality. He writes, "I lie down and sleep. I wake again because the Lord sustains me. Because the Lord sustains me. I will not fear, though tens of thousands assail me on every side." Look, David spent years of his life running from people who were trying to kill him. But he never lost sight of the reality that God is in control. I mean, this is why he prayed, because God is in control. Now, we may never fully understand the evil that we experience, but we need to know this. God has evil on a leash. God has evil on a leash. It is ultimately under his control. And you know what? You matter to him. You matter to him. Listen to what Jesus says. "Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. And even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows." Reject fear. Number five, look to the cross. Look to the cross. Now, as we have seen, David, like generations of Israelites after him, was crying out to God to bring justice to his enemies. "Arise, Lord, deliver me, my God. Strike all my enemies on the jaw. Break the teeth of the wicked." In Psalm 75, Asaph proclaimed, "Yes, the Lord is the judge of all the earth. No one from the east or the west or from the desert can exalt themselves. It is God who judges. He brings one down, he exalts another." And then Asaph goes on to say that God has prepared a cup of wrath for the wicked. He writes, "In the hand of the Lord is a cup full of foaming wine mixed with spices. He pours it out, and all the wicked of the earth drink it down to its very dregs." Now, for centuries, the Israelites were waiting for God to make their enemies drink this cup of wrath. And then something shocking happened. God gave it to Jesus. God gave it to Jesus. Jesus fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour? He went away a second time and prayed, "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done." You know, Jesus didn't go to the cross for good people. He went for the wicked. And this has profound implications for us. Not only can God deal with the evil in my soul, God can deal with the evil in my enemy's soul. And this affects how I pray. It doesn't mean that justice is any less important. Actually, just the opposite, in fact. But what the cross means is that my enemy can become my brother. My enemy can become my brother. You know, when Jesus was praying in the garden, his disciples were about to just flee from him and abandon him. I mean, Peter would deny even knowing him. And yet before all of that happened, Jesus offered them a different cup, the cup of forgiveness. Jesus took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." Jesus drank a cup of wrath so that we could drink the cup of forgiveness. Jesus drank a cup of wrath so that we can drink the cup of forgiveness. Friends, this is it. This, in the end, is how we overcome evil. We drink from the cup of forgiveness, and then we offer it to our enemies. Evil will not have the victory. Our God has overcome it by the cross. Therefore, don't give up on the goodness of God. Don't give up on the goodness of God. Remember your identity. Don't stop feeling. Reject fear. And above all, look to the cross. Look to the cross. Let's go to God in prayer. Lord God, we love you. Lord God, you have overcome evil for all time through the cross. Thank you, O God, that you will give us the victory over evil in our lives. Father, right now I pray for every person suffering from the pain of evil inflicted upon them. God, I pray that you would strengthen them to go to the cross to receive healing. Lord, that there would be freedom, that there would be peace, that there would be wholeness. God, that they would receive forgiveness and extend forgiveness. Thank you, God, that we are who you say we are, that we don't have to live in shame and humiliation because you are the one who lifts our heads high. Thank you, God. Evil will not win in our lives, in our family, in our city, in our nation, in the world. Evil will not win. Just while we're in this moment of prayer, maybe you're listening today and you're thinking, I need God. I need him to rescue me. I need him to save me from the evil that's in my own soul. If that's where you are today, I want to encourage you to take a very simple step, to turn your heart to the Lord and say, God, here I am. I need you. Will you forgive me? I put my trust in you. I put my hope in you. Jesus, I receive the power of your resurrection into my life that I might live a new life. When we take these simple steps, God meets us in a powerful way. Thank you, God, that you're the healer of our souls, that you are our deliverer. Lord, that no expression of pain is too intense for you. Lord, that we can be honest. We don't have to bury our emotions, that we can bring all of it before you. Lord, you heal us, you hear us, and you change us. Thank you, God, that in you we have hope. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you, friends.